The overarching theme of the Kilkenomics Festival is the crisis over? And we've a number of people gathered here. David Mcwilliams is still with us, but we're joined hot foot from Dublin by Pat Rabbitte, Minister for Communications, Energy and Natural Resources, who's here on two missions, one to be with us and also a second one, which you will explain in a moment or two. John Mcguinness, the local Fianna Fail TD, chairman of the PAC and also the Fianna Fail spokesman on small business, is with us. Good morning to you, John. We've got Max Keiser, he of the Keiser Report, host of the Keiser Report stateside, and we've got Bill Black, an academic and lawyer and someone who put a lot of white collar criminals behind bars at the beginning of this crisis. We heard about the tornado in Kilmainham. Did you know there was a minor earthquake last night in Kilkenny? Did anyone hear that? The earth moved. Max Keiser was on his honeymoon.
That is absolutely true.
And it was the first night of your honeymoon, your wedding night you spent here.
Absolutely, Kilkenny is the romance spot of Europe, as everyone knows. And we lived up to that tradition.
Very good. Well, congratulations to you and Stacey, your beloved. And we might start with you, Max, though, anyway, on the question of, is the crisis over? Looking at us from afar, what do you think?
Well, when the airplane landed, we got off the airplane, and there's people waiting, cars picking up, and I saw one for Kohlberg, Kravers, and Roberts, KKR. And they are basically what you call vulture capitalists. They are here as undertakers. The country of Ireland's assets have been bled dry and are being bled dry. And KKR and other private equity groups are here to pick them off for pennies on the dollar. And so that's a bit sad. It's like a wake, unfortunately.
But does it mean that they reckon the prices have now hit rock bottom, this is the time to get in and do their vulturing?
Well, sure, but you lose your sovereignty, which is unfortunate, because that means the income-producing assets of the country are going to be going to foreigners, foreign banks, foreign companies. It won't be domestic. So that's very sad to see. And that's part of the game plan, because it's always been, going back 5-6 years, to pick off the smaller countries first, Ireland being one of them, bankrupt them, impose debts that they didn't incur onto the population, and bleed it dry, and then pick off the assets for pennies on the dollar. It's what on Wall Street's called a leverage buyout. They use that technique on a country, Ireland, to do a leverage buyout of Ireland. Now they're here to take their reward and leave everyone else dead broke. Sorry, but you've become fodder for Wall Street.
Okay, so we're not turning any corner anytime soon.
You're bleeding to death.
Bleeding to death. All right, Bill, from your point of view, how do you see it?
Well, as always, Max is excessively optimistic. Not to bring numbers into this or anything, but the Bank of Ireland, two of its economists just issued a report, and it followed up on a report a few months earlier, and they decided they'd extend it and look at more dimensions, comparing the Irish crisis to other crises since the Great Depression. And the results of both these studies are consistent. You're number one. The absolute worst economic crisis in Europe in 75 years, and it's not even close. And in case you want to be optimistic, they helpfully added that in prior severe crises, real estate prices fell typically from 10 to 15 years after the event began. So you've turned a corner and ran into an abutment.
So that's how you see it, that the end is not in sight. There's no light at the end of that tunnel.
Oh, well, of course, you are the special children now. Angela loves you. When Angela and the IMF love you, you know you have catastrophically bad policies. Right? Because Ireland is unique in that it decided that it would bail out Germany. Right? You were not on the hook as the Irish people.
So hang on, are you saying 5 million people were asked to bail out 70 million people?
They weren't asked, they volunteered. That's how insane the policy was, right? You have a financial crisis in the banks. The deal with the banks, right? German banks have loaned money to Irish banks, and the deal is, if the Irish bank goes under, we get repaid cents on the dollar. And the subordinated debt, the deal was, you get repaid zero.
Are you saying that that's the deal, that all these guys who, when they lend money, they go in eyes wide open, and they say, okay, we're giving money to Anglo, we're giving money to Bank of Ireland, to AIB, we know what we are doing, we are taking a certain chance, they thought the risk was low, they were wrong, and they should pay.
And they're the most financially sophisticated entities in the world, and they got a premium interest rate because they took the risk.
Okay.
And then you turn around and say, no, why don't we gift you $30 billion, right? Ireland's a rich nation, Germany's a poor nation, why should we transfer $30 billion to you? And of course you couldn't pay for it. So you transform a banking crisis into an absolutely unsolvable budgetary crisis. Whereupon they say, you know what the answer is? Austerity. We should make the recession worse, and we should cut your wages. We call this the road to Bangladesh strategy. So you've got to cut your wages so that you can outcompete the Spanish, who are cutting their wages so they can outcompete the Portuguese, who are cutting their wages so they can outcompete the Greeks, who are cutting their wages so they can outcompete the Turks. And this leads to the happy equilibrium, if you're an employer, of Bangladesh. It takes 10 to 15 years. But that's what this Max is talking about. This is part of the
Minister, is this how you understood the crisis when you took over in government? Or are they being too stark?
Well, I put it slightly differently, but yes, I understood it. Yes, I understood it on a particular night on Primetime where former Minister Pat Carey and myself debated it. I said exactly that night what the impact of us handing over our sovereignty would be and how it would tie the hands of incoming governments, and against the background of the bank guarantee, that we were now in this situation. I mean, it is the worst, if you combine the impact of the recession with the banking collapse, it is the worst recession since the Second World War, the worst experience that we have had. Having said all of that, I mean, I don't think, I wouldn't quite agree with Bill or Max in the manner in they presented, you know, I don't think that when the German banks poured money into the banks in this country after the euro, the creation of the euro, I don't think that they did it deliberately in the belief that Ireland would bail out Germany one day. They did it because the banks here were gobbling up cheap money to fuel a property bubble that wasn't sustainable.
The reason we had cheap money was that Germany needed cheap money. We didn't need cheap money. We needed money at normal kind of rates of interest. But the German economy was in trouble. Therefore, because in spite of what the finance minister says, Mr. Schauble says, that he's nothing to do with the ECB, they do dominate things that happen in the ECB. They needed cheap money. That meant Europe got cheap money. That meant Ireland got cheap money. That meant we had a boom. If there was no cheap money, no boom.
Well, Germany obviously is a dominant force. I mean, you know, we like to present it as a union of 27 equal member states. When it comes to a crisis like this, you discover it's not exactly equal. Of course, they're a dominant force. But the fact of the matter is that our banks had a voracious appetite for swallowing up cheap money because they were funding an unsustainable property bubble. And the fact of the matter is that it was that cheap money that transferred this liability. If it weren't for the bank guarantee, you know, the circumstance may very well be different now. But it was the period leading up to the bank guarantee where no action was taken. I mean, people have forgotten that there were citizens queuing on the streets of Dublin because there was a run on Northern Rock Bank some 13 months earlier. So what happened between 13 months and September of that year? I mean, of the following year? I mean, I say that because any minister for finance, and whether it was Pat Kenny or any of the economists here, confronted on the night with the leaders of the major banks in Ireland saying to Brian Lenihan at the time, if you don't do this, there will be a run on the banks in the morning and there won't be money in the ATMs and the banking system will collapse. Anybody presented with that, it's like being a bomb disposal expert in Northern Ireland. There's a blue wire and a red wire. And if you cut the wrong wire, you know, it is one huge risk. But my point is, ever since Northern Rock and in the preceding 13 months, we didn't seem to do any preparation for what befell us. And we didn't believe that it was, and we argued at the time that it wasn't a solvency issue, that it was only a liquidity issue, and that the guarantee would never be called in. I mean, I remember saying in the House at the time that Brian Cowan had bet the keys, the deeds of the country on the guarantee. And the almost cavalier approach at the time was, it'll never be called in.
And John Mcguinness, that were your party in government. We know there was profligacy, we know there was lack of regulation, we know the early warning signs were not there, were not heeded, we know that the famous mantra of Charlie McCreevy, which was continued, when we have it, we'll spend it, when we don't have it, we won't spend it, all that sort of stuff, it was mad.
It was mad, and there is no doubt about it, but that Fianna Fail-led government made huge mistakes that has led us to where we are. There were policy mistakes, there were bad judgment calls, and they have caused, now have caused a serious crisis within the economy and the society that Ireland is. In opposition, you hear many things described as a crisis, a missed opportunity, but I have never heard the stark description that has been given to us this morning by Bill and Max. And it's interesting to listen to that from two outsiders viewing Ireland as we are right now. And it is quite clear that we are not being told the absolute truth, either by the government or by the leaders in Europe.
But isn't it fair, from the government's point of view, and put it to the minister, that we don't have the absolute truth yet? We don't know what's going to happen to the promissory notes. We don't know what kind of a deal we're going to get on our banking stroke sovereign debt. We don't know yet. We're promised we're the special child. There is an imperative for the Germans and their partners in the EU who are like-minded to see one country that's in a bailout become a success. And it seems that we are that adopted child.
But all of the promises and rhetoric that we hear from Europe these days, particularly from Germany, will not feed that child. And society in Ireland is broken, families are broken, businesses are broken. You have heard this morning from some people in your audience as I came in,
yeah,
the attempts that they have made to get jobs, to get in employment, to reinvent themselves. So there is a resilience out there, and there is a desire within the Irish people to get on with their lives and to get jobs. And we do it in an incredible way. For example, in this constituency today, there is a new business being opened. There is Plan B, a breaking new ground on foreign markets against the odds, against the fact that China is in itself not performing as well as it should at 7% and so on. So we do all that, but there is another economy which was described for you this morning, which is the retail sector, the business people in Ireland, the indigenous sector of business people creating sustainable jobs, at one time employing 850,000 people. They are in serious difficulty. And the promises made with regard to upward-only rent reviews and legislation in that area came to naught by this government. In fact, the government itself has upward-only rent reviews, and the tenants have handed back the keys. So I'm pointing to that to say that there is a very little understanding of the business sector in this country and the difficulties.
Minister, I want to go back to that point about not the full picture, because the boys, Max and Bill, are saying that it is stark, it is catastrophic, we've been sold a pup. And I'm suggesting, and maybe you want to go along with this, that maybe we don't see the full picture yet, and some of this catastrophic debt may be lifted.
No, we don't. We don't see the full picture yet. The fact of the matter is that because we were in first, because the crash was deepest and first in Ireland, we have found ourselves burdened with private debt that the citizens didn't incur as a result of ECB insistence.
Well, this is what I was going to ask you. Can you enlighten us about the strong-arming by Mr. Trichet that night?
Well, I don't know how wise it is to say how much, but I have no doubt but that we were strong-armed at the time, or the then government was strong-armed into the appalling decisions that were made.
And do you believe that was because Mr. Trichet and his colleagues at the ECB knew what would happen if one, two, three, or more of the German or French banks went woke?
I don't think that they knew, Pat, but they feared what the impact of contagion would be. I have reached the stage in my life, you know, that comfortable stage when you were younger, when you always believed there was someone above you who knew what they were doing. I have reached a stage in my life where I believe I know as much about it as anybody else.
Okay.
And I don't think they knew, but they feared the impact of contagion. And they made the decision they made. Now remember, the Irish government was at that time, and had been for some time, entirely dysfunctional. And the ECB didn't believe Irish politicians then, or didn't believe the bankers then. The bankers were misrepresenting the picture in Frankfurt and in Brussels and so on. So as a result, the ECB asserted the veto that they did. Now that means that, as a result, we are dealing with two legacy issues. One, and they're separate, one is the promissory note, and the other is the inherited.
Would I be right in reading the tea leaves and thinking that the promissory note job will become a 40-year mortgage or even a 50-year mortgage and will cease to loom large on the horizon? Is that a fair assumption, or is that just a vain hope?
Everything in this, Pat, has been two steps forward and one step back, and it is very difficult going. It's very difficult going for a number of reasons. You're within sight of the finishing line and something pushes you back down the queue. A bigger crisis in Greece or Spain or whatever it is. But yes, there is detailed, painstaking work going on the restructuring of the promissory note.
It seems fairly straightforward, you know. I mean, explain to Mrs. Merkel about the war reparations from World War One that she finished off paying last year. It's the same sort of principle, you know, and why she can't just...
It's a straightforward issue to make that point, but it's, you know, if you're greeted with, you know, resistance in different institutions of the Union, it is difficult. On the second issue of the debt, the situation on the debt is that we are making definite progress, in my view.
All right.
The decision of the 29th of June, Pat, has not unwound. That is the legal
Ireland
formal
is
position,
a special case.
And that
I
is
to
very
Max
important.
And Bill, and David is listening to this with his eyebrows arched.
No, my quick comment is that the Prime Minister needs a girl pair.
Yes.
Okay.
You know what I'm saying? He needs to stand up for the country.
Testicular growth is what you
an empty suit. Now, you know, people talk about the policy mix that was incorrect. They're not bringing up the F word, fraud. There was a massive fraud. And, you know, here you have a guy, Sean Quinn, who's in the paper today.
Now, his case is before the courts, and we will not have a
fine. Yeah, I'm not concatenating my word fraud with Sean Quinn, okay? I'm not making that connection. That's just a coincidence that I mentioned the word fraud, and then I mentioned Sean Quinn. That was just a mere coincidence, a limerick, if you will.
Certainly no one on this program would
there
go along
a
with such a contention.
Who was a jerk, and then he... No, I'll leave that to... So here the headline is, warning of civil unrest if Quinn is sent to prison. And I thought immediately, like, oh, wow, people are finally getting to the streets to hang this bastard. It turns out that, no, it's the other way around. People support him. They support him. Now, here's the next headline in the very same paper. Intruder raped me, then asked for a hug.
Same principle.
Sean Quinn raped me, asked for a hug. Are you insane?
Okay, so David, focus
focusing on really bad Irish decisions, right? Greatest own goals in the history of Ireland. And, you know, there's a fair history of own goals in Ireland. But the spectacularly bad decisions are being made by Germany.
Explain.
Germany has thrown the entire Eurozone into an utterly gratuitous recession with this absolutely insane austerity principle. So why will you have any confidence that they will actually reach the right decision when it comes to Ireland? As you say, there are a number of straightforward answers to what should be done that should have been done years ago if Germany were rational.
Okay, the point being that if they wreck Europe through austerity,
no, they have wrecked. It's okay. Not a conditional subjunctive.
Okay, but that point being that if Europe is not functioning, if it is
not
economically dysfunctional,
Europe is in recession completely gratuitously.
It means Germany is effectively damaging itself.
But it's interesting if you talk about
and everybody else.
We started with this idea that there was this expression: when I have money, I spend it. When I don't have it, I don't spend it. And there was an assumption that that's a bad thing to do, that policy doesn't make any sense. This is exactly what we're doing now. When we have money, we spend it. When we don't, we don't. So when we have money, we exacerbate the upswing, it becomes much more flamboyant. When we don't, we exacerbate the downturn, the austerity. It seems to me that what's going to happen here, this is all a phony debate, a phony war, because ultimately what is going to have to happen in Europe, which we will benefit from, is the ECB is going to have to behave like a proper central bank, like the Federal Reserve in the United States or the Bank of England, which means it will have to buy the treasuries of the countries, i.e. they will have to go in and give money to the governments, number one. And number two, the fiscal compact will eventually be torn up, because Europe has 25 million people on the dole. 25 million. It also has interest rates at 1% in Germany. If that doesn't scream a government expansion, nothing does. And this will be solved like the 1930s was solved in the United States by a central bank injecting ample liquidity and by governments spending to bring the economy's demand up, to kickstart the economy. This is what's going to happen. Germany at the moment is leading itself and everybody else up a garden path. Right. And the model is German unification.
Okay,
German unification was a success because
large
Germany spent
Greece.
Its way out of it.
Right.
And that's going to happen again.
I want to go back to Bill and Max just on one thing. I mean, the wasteland that you both have laid out in front of us. If what Minister Pat Rabbitte and his colleagues in Cabinet are trying to achieve in terms of the promissory notes and in terms of the other debt being treated in a special way because we were strong-armed into doing something we shouldn't have done. If we get a result on that, what then, Bill? Will we be okay?
No, you'll be a little less bad. And when I painted that picture, that wasn't Bill Black. That's the Irish Central Bank's picture, right? So let's remember that. But you would be less worse off. That would certainly be true if they had less punishing austerity. But the regime would still remain austerity. And here, you know, back to the hug me point that Max is making, there have been two things put to the Irish people for a vote. And you voted insanely on both of them. So you had voted in favor of austerity with the Stability and Growth Pact. Right. And you voted against an inquiry. So no one's being held accountable.
You're talking about the Doyle, the Oireachtas Committee's referendum that we rejected.
Yeah, I was going to butcher the pronunciation of it.
Okay, Max, what is your view in terms of we get some sort of deal?
Ireland closed the embassy in the Vatican for reasons of pedophilia and rape, and they should do something similar with these banksters. Who are financially raping the country. You should take a stand against them. You know, in France, they're passing legislation now to classify crimes of this type as pornography and pedophilia, to apply a negative stigma to financial rapists like the gentleman I mentioned earlier and another one named Sean. So that when they go down the street, people look at them and say, they look at them like they would look at Jimmy Savile. Over in the UK.
We can't really make those kind of comparisons in this jurisdiction. It is not appropriate. Because we're using rape, and that analogy is not one that we we would choose.
And it's so apt, Pat. It's so true. I understand, Max, people are in pain here.
Imposing insurance levies on us because of the bad behavior of the Quinn Insurance Group is effectively financially...
Who runs this country, Pat? The government, the people, or some schmuck bankster?
Okay, John.
Our case and tells us that we are a special case. It also looks at Italy, which is in deep trouble, supported by its black economy. It's looking at Greece, which is a basket case. Spain, which has yet not given up the true figures. We don't know what's happening in France in terms of their 30 billion euro deficit and their pensions. Their automobile industry is in trouble. People are leaving that country. And they are looking at us and wondering what is happening in the other countries. And we're not taking into account what the UK government are doing. We're not working with them or closely enough with them to determine why they are so anti-European. And we are not looking at the budgets of Europe, which essentially are ripping off every country that is a member, because it is now costing a colossal amount of money to run Europe. So Germany is there in the middle, trying to, as it were, hold the centre, while everything else is falling around us. And the truth in Europe is not being told. And therefore, we are being just kept on a string in this country.
Minister.
And can I just agree with the other speakers? It is now becoming an embarrassment to see our ministers and their Taoiseach go there, cap in hand. And I appreciate what Pat would say, well, it's Fianna Fail's fault. But it's embarrassing to see Angela Merkel, or to hear her say yesterday, you're doing a great job, lads, there's a tap on the back for you, and we'll all come out as a stronger for it.
Well,
that is
no
not
doubt.
True.
There's no doubt. We're in dangerous times. I mean, in our lifetime, the Cardinals were in control in Greece, and indeed in Spain. People at the bottom of the pile in Greece at the moment are hungry. One in every two young people under 25 in Spain are unemployed. It is a very dangerous and fragile situation. Having said that, Pat, I believe that you can point to very significant and substantial progress since Draghi took over the leadership of the ECB. There have been a number of very major changes, and I think that there is evidence that at the top of the institutions in Europe now, there is an appreciation that the crisis has become so serious that solutions
okay.
must be advanced.
One last thing, and this is a point Bill made last night. In terms of rescuing this economy, you've got to put money back in people's pockets. And he's saying that there is debt, personal debt, mortgage debt, that is unsustainable, and they've got to start writing off debt. We heard AIB saying they're doing it on a piecemeal basis, dealing with people one by one, and they are writing off debt. They were given billions and billions to write off the debt. They've used less than a billion of that to write off debt. They're not doing what we paid them to do out of taxpayers' money.
The progress is very slow, just like it's very slow on lending, especially to the SME sector. There's no doubt about that. The personal insolvency bill, which is designed to deal with the personal indebtedness issue, including secured, i.e. in this
okay,
case,
but,
mortgage debt,
just a second,
will
Mr.
be finished next week.
Bill, you made the point that corporation to corporation, when they reach difficulties, they deal with it in a very mature and efficient way. Explain.
Yeah, this is called a troubled debt restructuring, and you routinely, business to business, write down the principal, reduce the interest rate, because it's better to be paid something than to have the thing default, and there's no moral connotation to any of this.
None of this moral hazard stuff.
Right, and blaming the borrower and such. So, you know, fundamentally...
So banks and their customers should behave like business to business.
They should. And fundamentally, look, what it comes down to is, you talked about the unemployment rate. In Spain and Greece, over 50% young people. Why is the unemployment rate for Irish young people falling? Is it because the economy is recovering?
No.
It's because people are voting with their feet, that there is not a future for me, that when what I do when I grow up, I go to university, I get my passport, and I go.
Exporting human capital. That's what we're doing.
The sickle joke that
okay,
the Ireland's
Minister,
leading export is the
that
Irish.
Happens, Pat, the banks continue to put taxpayers' money to their bottom line and improve their position, their pensions. and they are not considering the citizens of this country or their customers.
Minister, I won't let you go before you tell us what your other mission is.
Well, I'm here to do a couple of things in relation to the Children's Amendment, but I'm also down at the Father McGrath Centre, where my own department funds a scheme on digital inclusion, a scheme which is designed to facilitate people who didn't have the opportunity to get a basic element of computer literacy
might be left behind
at the earlier stages of their lives, and now through voluntary groups of one kind and another, this scheme permits people to acquire basic computer literacy and to, you know, use the internet, whether it is, just as the point has been made about immigration, to make contact with their children in Australia or Germany or whatever it is. People generally appreciate it, and for a small amount of money, it has trained some 40,000 people.
Okay, well, Minister, thank you very much. I wish you well in that endeavour. We let the Minister go. I want to talk to Max Abdil about presidential politics, American presidential politics, for a couple of minutes after 11, but now we'll take a break.